Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum, dear students. Today's lecture is last one of the theme Forensic Sexology. It includes two subtypes which I will discuss. Number one, medico-legal examination of sexual offender. Number two is sexual perversions. Examination of sexual offender. This is third examination today of this examination series. It's the third medico-legal examination in sexual offences, and before that I have described two exams which are examination of female victim of rape and examination of female victim of sodomy or male victim of sodomy. Usually the offender after doing the act kills the victim, which are weak and unable to defend, like women and children, and escapes from scene of crime and may be caught later by police. Anyhow, if caught on the spot or later, he is brought to medico-legal clinic, and the examination is most useful if he is caught immediately after crime. So all the evidence on his body and clothes is available and collected. So what is the protocol or steps of examination of offender? They are similar like previous exams, but different in genital region, because genital region itself is different. That is, it is male sex organs like penis and scrotum. Preferably it should be done by same doctor, medical examiner, who examined the victim, so he can better relate findings in both parties. He must understand and appreciate the disproportion in the physical state of assailant and victim and consistency of the resultant damage. So, continuing this protocol are steps of examination of sexual offender. What is the team which does this examination? If this is the medical examiner and his assistant, any nurse, male or female, and the examination room, that is called medico-legal clinic. Police brings the offender to the medico-legal clinic of assigned government hospital, such as any DHQ in periphery and any teaching hospital like Services Hospital and Mayo Hospital and General Hospital in Lahore. First of all, the examiner determines the personal identity of the offender, because that has to be verified. That is a legal requirement. Consent of the offender should be obtained, but it doesn't matter if he refuses to consent. Even then, examination will be carried out forcefully, because being offender, he has no such right to refuse the consent. Then general impression of the offender will be seen, observed. Then history of the event will be asked, what happened, how he did that. He will either accept it or deny it. Anyhow, he will have to face the questions. Then his examination will start like from general body examination for any trace evidence or any injury, sign of resistance, which shows signs of resistance by the victim or anything on his body. Then systemic examination, which is of these systems of the body like cardiovascular system, nervous system and other systems. This is very important because the patient may claim to be heart patient and is so he is not able to commit that crime, but the systemic examination will either confirm or rule out that. After that, the specific examination, local examination or genital examination, that is of scrotum and penis will be taken place. During all these steps, any specimens will be collected and sent to police and lab for analysis. And later, after that, when the report comes from the lab, the examiner will certify or issue a certificate or report. He will prepare based on the findings of examination and investigations, and that report will be sent to court via police. So those were in brief the steps of general examination, systemic examination, etc., which I have discussed in detail in previous first examination, that is female victim of rape. So the protocol is the same. Next we take up the examination of male genitalia. The male genitalia are penis and testes enclosed in scrotum. They are examined in two steps, number one inspection and number two palpation. Now what we will see, our examiner will see in inspection. On inspection, he will be able to confirm the status of penis and scrotum, including testes. That is, these are sex organs may be present or absent. If they are absent, then allegation of rape is false. Number two, the examiner also finds out any deformity in this area which may interfere with intercourse, so which may make prove the offender impotent. Even then, allegation becomes false. Then stage of development or disease of penis affecting erection and ejaculation. All these medical conditions, deformities, they can go into benefit of offender. Now doctor has to pay attention to the size of penis in relation to the extent of damage caused to vulva or anus of the victim. Then he will note any injury, swellings, signs of bleeding or any other damage. After that, he has to find out or note any biological foreign deposits transferred from the victim. So he will note them. Now coming to pubic hair, extent of pubic hair growth, swelling, that means any dirt or particle from environment. Matting, that means the hair are clumped together and thick mass become a thick mass, that is called matting. And presence of loose hair, they are noted by the examiner. If after palpation there is no gross pathological lesion of the penis and scrotum, offender is considered capable of performing sexual intercourse. Now what is palpation? After inspection, the examination will move towards palpation. So palpation, as you know, is by moving the hand, palmar surface of hand on the body, and note anything. So this will confirm presence of tenderness, state of penis and testes in scrotal sac, for example, undescended testes, hernia, testicular atrophy, or any other testicular lesion. This is not much visible in in inspection. It becomes more clear in on palpation. Now, vaginal epithelium from the body of the victim, which sticks onto glans penis, can easily be detected by painting it with dilute iodine solution, and vaginal epithelium stains dark brown. So this small test will confirm the presence of vaginal epithelium on penis. That means sexual act was committed by the offender. After inspection and palpation and determining the status of genitalia given above, doctor will not note injuries on other parts of the body such as face and chest of the victim. Secondary sex characters like extent and quality of hair growth on the face, chest and axilla of the offender are to be noted to assess maturity and ability to perform sexual act. Now after this, next step is collection of specimens. Same list of specimens as in previous two examinations. I have shown you and discussed you that previous two exams, the slide of collection of specimens, which is also there in the book table 9.11. So for details, again you consult that table. The list headings are same. So I discuss only swabs and some findings from clothes. Other steps you can see and correlate from there. The swabs to be collected from the genital area of assailant are: number one, there are four places from where examiner will collect the swabs in from genital area. Number one, from external urethral opening. Number two, from glans penis. Number three, from corona or rim of glans penis. Number four, from shaft of penis. Now, clothes should be inspected for any soiling by environmental factors such as dirt, mud, etc., grass, and for semen stains, which are commonly found on the trouser or shalwar and inner surface of lower part of shirt. Fly of the trouser of the victim is usually stained with semen. After that, examination is over, but medico-legal certificate I have not discussed before any exam. So for all these three exams, number one, examination of female victim of rape, number two, examination of male or female victim of sodomy, and number three, examination of sexual offender, for all these examinations, examiner, medical examiner or doctor has to issue, write a report, or you can call it a certificate. It is of medico-legal nature because it relates with law and it also contains medical findings. So medico-legal certificate or forensic certificate or medical certificate of sexual offender or sexual victim, it is same thing, it is same certificate. So you don't have to be confused. So now for medico-legal certificate for offender, it is a legal requirement of law and law courts. So doctor has to prepare it and give one copy to victim or assailant and one copy to court, and one copy he has to keep in record. So it is very important document. It contains all findings, observations, assessments, history points, and investigations, and at the end the most important part is the conclusion or his opinion. So it should include both positive and negative findings on the body of assailant. Opinion must be based on the recorded data. If damage to vagina of victim, female victim, is proportionate to the size of penis of the assailant, it should be clearly certified, stating that the medical examination findings are consistent with the allegation. So this is very important point, because that will help to identify and determine the responsibility of this act on assailant. After this, the examination part is over. So there were three main sub-themes in sexology. Number one was pregnancy and abortion. Number two was these sexual offences and their examinations. And number three and last sub-theme is sexual perversions. So what is a perversion? These are habitual acts intended to result in sexual gratification or pleasure without sexual act. So usually sexual act is not performed, and actually these are deviations. These are not normal behavior. They are very abnormal and strange behavior. So for example, homosexuality is one example. And what is the cause of this behavior? It is some kind of psychological or psychiatric problem. In all such cases, it is necessary to have the mental state of the person or accused or victim assessed by a psychiatrist for the purpose of law and courts. Because when this case is brought to the court, mental status examination of offender or victim or anyone involved in sexual perversions is important to determine the criminal responsibility. Now, types of sexual perversions. Now, this topic is given in chapter 4 of Naseeb Awan, and there is a table given which you can see. So some portion of forensic sexology you will find in chapter 4, and the main portion is in chapter 9 of Naseeb Awan. So here is a list of those perversions. They are 13 in number, and first I read out, then I describe them. Number one is sadism. Number two, masochism. Number three, homosexuality. Number four, lesbianism. Number five, transsexualism. Number six, transvestism or onism. Number seven, pedophilia. Number eight, voyeurism. Number 9, exhibitionism. 10, bestiality. 11, necrophilia. 12, fetishism. And 13, uranism. So number 1 is sadism. Sadism is giving pain to his partner name, this name sadism is derived from a French novelist Marquis de Sade, and he wrote novels in which his characters are involved in this activity. They are sadist. This is more common in males, and the sadist person, he bites, flogs, injures and ill treats his partner. Now, injuries on the body of the partner are found on breast and external genitalia and other parts. Now, he has a severe desire or frenzy to commit violent acts, that is lust murder. So he likes to kill after sexual pleasure. He likes to kill his partner, and also then when the person is, other person is dead, he wants to eat or eats his body parts. Number two is masochism. Masochist gets pleasure by receiving pain from the partner. This name masochism is derived from Austrian novelist Leopold Secher Masoch. If both sadism and masochism are found together, this is called sadomasochism or bondage. Now, what is the medico-legal importance of this masochism? That is, these people are involved in accidental hanging or sexual or autoerotic asphyxia, which you already know, it has been taught to you in asphyxia. Number third is homosexuality. It is obtaining of sexual stimulation and pleasure by partners of the same sex or from partner of the same sex. Number four is lesbianism. It is sexual stimulation and gratification between two females, that is also same sex but they are female. Number five, transsexualism. This means desire to adopt the opposite sex. These people, they want to change their sex, and some of them, they are successful in changing their sex by surgery. Number six is transvestism, is also called onism. This is sexual pleasure derived by wearing dress of the opposite sex. Now, On was a Frenchman. So, the transvestite male, the person who likes to wear the dress of opposite sex, is called transvestite. Male finds pleasure in wearing female garments, and transvestite female finds pleasure in wearing male dress. Both do this to be identified with opposite sex. Now, these people have close association with sexual or autoerotic asphyxia, like masochists. Number seven, perversion is pedophilia. This is sexual love and urge with prepubescent child. That means, prepubescent means before puberty. So those young children who are under 10 or 11 or 12 years of age, they are the targets of those people who are pedophiles. Number eight, voyeurism. It is the sexual gratification or pleasure by looking at naked picture or body of the opposite sex. So they are also called peeping toms. Number 9, perversion is exhibitionism. These are those people who get sexual pleasure by showing or exposing sex organs to the members of the opposite sex. Number 10 is bestiality. This is transference of object of sexuality from human beings to animals. That means these people get their sexual pleasure from animals. Number 11 is necrophilia. This is some people develop or have desire to use dead body to obtain sexual pleasure. That is called necrophilia. Number 12, fetishism. It's transference of object of sexuality from human beings to belongings of the opposite sex. That is, they seek pleasure from these objects like their shoes, jewelry, glasses, etc. of opposite sex. Number 13 is uranism. It is perversion of sexual instincts. This is for more detail of it, you can see it is discussed in Parikh. Now, this perversion topic is also over, and with that, whole forensic sexology is complete. I have collected some SCQs which are important, which have been asked in prof and test. So you can note them and try to prepare on these, answer these questions from these lectures and from the chapter 9 and chapter 4 of Naseeb-e-Aman, and some aspect, few pages of Parikh, like definition of rape, etc., you can see from Parikh. So what are these SCQs? Number 1, a female child victim of rape is brought for medico-legal examination. What are the procedural steps and findings confirming this case? So this is steps of examination of female victim of rape. Number 2, enlist the steps of medico-legal examination in victim of sodomy. Describe the genital examination. So you will just write the name of the steps, but you will describe the genital examination in detail. That will be of anus. Number 3, describe briefly the collection of specimens from the female victim and offender in a case of rape. So here you will read that table in chapter 9, which I have told you before in the beginning, which gives you all list of specimens for all exams. Number 4, name and classify the drugs used to induce the criminal abortion. And number 5 is also about those drugs. Classify the abortifacient drugs, giving their mechanism of action. So these this table is given in Naseeb-e-Aman and in my lecture. So you should consult and read it. Number 6, how death occurs in a pregnant woman from criminal abortion. Or this question is asked another way, describe briefly the fatal complications of criminal abortion, or what are causes of death in criminal abortion. So all these, this question can be asked in different ways. So this complications are given in the book, fatal complications are given in the book and in my lecture. Number 7, A and B. A, define iskate hamal and iskate janin. This definition you will find in chapter 4 of Naseeb-e-Aman and in my lectures. Number B, superfetation. This definition you will also find in Naseeb-e-Aman chapter 9 and my notes, lecture notes. And number 8 is write short notes on, these are 5 short notes have been asked in different exams. A, impotence. B, onism, which we discussed today, or sadomasochism or bondage. same thing. Number 3, twin pregnancy. Number 4, autopsy findings in a case of criminal abortion. And number 5, medico-legal certificate in sexual offences. It was also discussed in today's lecture. With that, I conclude my lecture. Thank you very much.